chronic renal or kidney disease is the permanent loss of the kidney's function. The kidneys play a number of important roles, including excreting toxins through urination as the kidneys fail. Toxins can build up that further harm the kidney and also can make the pet feel ill. Although renal disease cannot be cured without a kidney transplant, appropriate treatment can slow the progression of the disease and can make the pet feel much better. The diagnosis of renal disease relies on blood work and urinalysis. There can be many changes measured on lab work, but the most important are blood urea nitrogen, referred to commonly as BUN, creatinine, and urine-specific gravity. Elevation in BUN and creatinine and a decrease in urine-specific gravity is consistent with renal disease. BUN can elevate for many reasons, such as when a high-protein meal is fed, as well as when there is GI bleeding. So an elevated BUN alone doesn't necessarily mean that renal disease is present. Creatinine is a little more specific, and even increases towards the upper normal range can be suggestive of renal disease. Lower urine-specific gravity, also known as USG, occurs for multiple reasons, but failing kidneys lose their ability to concentrate urine, which results in low USG values. Unfortunately, although commonly measured, BUN and creatinine do not become elevated due to renal disease until 75% of kidney function has been lost. This makes initiating treatment to slow progression vital once a diagnosis of renal disease has been made. A key treatment for renal disease is nutritional therapy. The kidneys normally filter phosphorus in the blood and excrete it to maintain normal blood levels. The signal to excrete phosphorus is parathyroid hormone, referred to as PTH. PTH is released by the parathyroid gland located in the neck when blood levels of phosphorus go higher than normal. PTH concurrently maintains blood calcium levels by increasing calcium absorption and availability and reducing its excretion. Therefore, PTH signals to the intestinal tract to absorb more calcium from food, causes bone to break down to release calcium and with it phosphorus, and tells the kidney to retain calcium and excrete phosphorus. Since the kidneys cannot as effectively get rid of phosphorus when they are failing, phosphorus actually builds up with the release of PTH, which leads to more PTH release and then more phosphorus release from bone. This cycle results in higher circulating amounts of calcium and phosphorus, which can lead to mineralization of soft tissues. One of the soft tissues most susceptible to mineralization is the kidney. Mineralization of the kidneys causes damage, which, when only 25% of kidney function remains, can cause significant progression of renal disease and further loss of function. Therefore, the most important nutritional intervention for renal disease is dietary phosphorus restriction, which should reduce the likelihood of PTH excretion and damage from mineralization. Phosphorus is still an essential nutrient, so phosphorus-free diets are not used even if they were feasible, which they are not. Instead, phosphorus is typically reduced at least 20 to 30% from typical adult maintenance requirements. This typically translates to no more than about 1.2 grams of phosphorus per megacalorie, abbreviated mcal. The severity of phosphorus restriction generally is related to the severity of the disease, with lower phosphorus levels being used with more advanced disease. Dietary protein is restricted early in renal disease to enable dietary phosphorus restriction and later in the disease to also help the patient feel better. Protein-rich foods are typically also rich in phosphorus. Therefore, higher protein diets are typically higher in phosphorus. This generally means that less protein-rich foods are fed even early in disease. This does not necessarily mean that meat, poultry, fish has to be reduced, as fattier cuts and types can potentially still be fed if overall dietary phosphorus is restricted. The level of protein restriction is typically greater for dogs than it is for cats, as dogs as omnivores can readily adapt to reduced protein and amino acid intakes, while cats as obligate carnivores cannot. As disease progresses, dietary protein is not restricted solely to enable phosphorus restriction, but rather to help reduce the buildup of uremic toxins. These toxins are naturally found in food, especially from protein-rich foods. As the kidneys fail, these toxins increase in the blood, and they can lead to the pet feeling ill. This ill feeling can reduce appetite and result in GI problems like vomiting. Poor food intake results in the pet breaking down its own muscle, which can lead to further buildup of uremic toxins. It is not uncommon for the term azotemia to be used with pets suffering from renal disease. This relates to the buildup of BUN. BUN actually is not toxic, but does serve as an easily measured blood component that closely mirrors the levels of more difficult to measure uremic toxins. Thus, increases in BUN are typically associated with the patient feeling worse and their appetite becoming increasingly poor, finicky, or selective. Unfortunately, even though uremic toxin buildup will worsen how the pet feels, the pet may still be more willing to eat protein-rich foods that ultimately will make them feel even worse. Generally, needed protein restriction for dogs is less than 19% protein calories for early disease and less than 15% protein calories for more advanced disease. In cats, the level of protein restriction for all stages is around 21% protein calories to as high as 27% protein calories. In addition to phosphorus restriction, a lowering of the omega-6 to long-chain omega-3 fatty acid ratio can be potentially helpful in slowing the progression of renal disease. During an inflammatory process, the body's cells make cytokines, which are signaling molecules. Cytokines can be made from omega-6 or long-chain omega-3 fatty acids. Cytokines made from omega-6 fatty acids are better at signaling. This means that cytokines made from omega-3 fatty acids are not as effective at signaling, and as a consequence, consumption of foods rich in long-chain omega-3 fatty acids can actually reduce inflammation. This reduction in inflammation can prevent overzealous repair of stressed or damaged parts of the kidney, which can otherwise result in progression of renal disease. Although shorter chain omega-3 fatty acids, like alpha-linolenic acid that comes from terrestrial plants, can be elongated to the long chain omega-3 fatty acids EPA and DHA, their conversion is poor. Thus, the use of marine oils and or fish to enrich foods with these less inflammatory fatty acids. Ratios can be variable depending on what specific fatty acids are included in the calculation, but one often looks for linoleic acid plus arachidonic acid to EPA plus DHA ratios of less than 3. Blood volume can increase with increased dietary sodium intake. Since no more than the remaining 25% of the kidney function must still process 100% of the blood volume as the kidneys fail, additional blood volume increases put stress on the kidneys. This stress is in the form of increased blood pressure at the level of the kidney and at times systemically. Thus, dietary sodium is often reduced to significantly less than 1 gram per megacalorie in foods appropriate for renal disease. As kidney function is lost, the ability to concentrate urine is reduced, resulting in lower urine-specific gravities. This results in an increase in urine volume, which should result in a compensatory increase in water intake. This increased urine volume results in the potential for greater loss of water-soluble B vitamins. Thus, B vitamins are generally increased in foods appropriate for the nutritional management of renal disease. Along with increased B vitamin loss, more water is lost as the kidneys produce more dilute urine. If the pet doesn't drink enough water to keep up with this loss, they can become dehydrated. Dehydration in pets with renal disease can lead to more concentrated levels of uremic toxins, resulting in the pet feeling even worse and often a poor appetite. Thus, keeping a pet with renal disease well hydrated is very important. This can sometimes be accomplished with additional water bowls that are frequently refreshed, but often may mean the use of higher moisture meals or foods and or the administration of fluids at home under the skin. When fluids are given under the skin or subcutaneously, care should be taken to ensure that maintenance fluids are given, as other fluids like lactated Ringer solution, also known as LRS, or sodium chloride, can lead to hypernatremia or a high blood sodium level. It is always wise to have a veterinarian show one how to look for the signs of dehydration in a pet's mouth and by assessing skin turgor. The kidneys help regulate the acid-base balance of the body. Acid-base balance refers to maintaining a very tight range of overall body pH, especially with regard to the blood. Metabolic acidosis can occur with renal disease as the failing kidneys retain hydrogen ions and lose their ability to reabsorb bicarbonate ions. This results in the need for alkalinization therapy with supplements that provide useful ions and that also happen to provide essential nutrients like potassium citrate, sodium bicarbonate, and/or calcium carbonate. Metabolic acidosis can lead to further progression of renal disease and can increase the risk of hypokalemia or low blood potassium level. Thus, later in disease when metabolic acidosis is more common, acid-base status is often carefully monitored and treated. Potassium is a mineral that can become too high or too low in the blood with renal disease. The use of a common type of medication called ACE inhibitors can lead to an increased risk for hyperkalemia or high blood potassium level. Hyperkalemia can lead to restrictions in the foods that can be fed, as certain whole foods like whole potatoes or whole sweet potatoes can be too high in potassium. In addition, potassium-restricted foods are not common, which means that, depending on the severity of the problem, a home-cooked diet may be indicated, as reported by Segev et al. In 2010. Often foods designed for the nutritional management of renal disease are more energy-dense. This means that they have more kilocalories per cup or unit of volume. This means that when pets are not eating as well, they may still be able to meet their energy needs with less mouthfuls of food. Increasing energy density can be achieved by using highly digestible ingredients and/or making the food higher in fat. Fat provides more than twice the calories as protein or carbohydrate per gram. But unfortunately, increasing dietary fat increases the risk of fat intolerance. Therefore, care should be taken to ensure that the pet tolerates higher fat foods if this approach is taken. It is worth noting that cats appear to be more tolerant to higher fat levels than dogs. Typically, foods with approximately 400 kilocalories or more per cup, where one cup equals 237 mils, would be considered more energy dense. Pets with renal disease need to be carefully monitored. A major concern is the development of dehydration and/or weight loss. Pets that cannot drink enough water to prevent dehydration may need to be given periodic subcutaneous maintenance fluids. Pets that cannot eat enough to maintain an appropriate body condition may need to be tried on an alternative food that is appropriate for the nutritional management of renal disease. Sometimes pets develop learned aversions, where they associate their sense of ill feeling with the food they are currently being fed, which necessitates rotation to another food to increase food intake. Even with readily accepted foods, some pets do not eat enough calories to meet their needs, and the use of a feeding tube may be recommended or needed. These tubes, surgically inserted permanently in the neck or stomach, are not something everyone wishes to consider, but many pets can do extremely well with these tubes long term, as they can provide a way to ensure medication, fluid, and appropriate food is taken daily. With the right care, pets with renal disease can often live comfortably for the rest of their lives.